the Real Solid Snake, and welcome to another episode of the Irish Critics. Now, we all know that the new Superman film Man of Steel is coming out this Friday, and it looks unbelievably epic. That trailer that came out there a while ago is probably one of the most epic trailers I've ever seen in my life. I can't wait for this movie. I'm sure it's going to kick ass. With that being said, here in the Irish Critics, I'm going to be reviewing all the first four Superman movies, pretty much akin to our Batman week last year with the release of The Dark Knight Rises. This is going to be just something similar. So, to start us off, let me talk about the movie for today's episode, Superman. I love this movie. It has a great cast for great characters, the direction was great, and the music was just epic. Starring the late, great, and truest Superman ever, Christopher Reeve, it was promoted with the tagline, "You'll believe a man can fly." It did just that. The influence to this day and age still goes strong, as many of you will no doubt have seen in Bryan Singer's 2006 movie, Superman Returns. Anyways, let's just get started with this movie now. Here it is, the very first Superman movie ever. Listen to that music. Kind of feels a bit like 2001, doesn't it? Now we're in this huge dark room with three people dressed in black. They are on trial and Marlon Brando appears to be the prosecutor or some sorts. This here, folks, is of course General Zod, played by Terrence Stamp, and two other people whose names I have never ever got. I just called them the other guy and the other girl from the Zod gang.
No matter that it takes an eternity, you will bow down before me! Both you! And then one day, your ass!
And that's the last we see of them in this movie. No, really, that is the last we see of them in this movie. Now, when I see this movie all those years ago, I often ask, what was the point of that entire scene? I mean, if those three characters serve no purpose to the plot whatsoever in this movie, then what was the hell? What was the point of even including them in it? It made no sense. Yes, we all know it was to set it up for Superman 2, but it didn't even give any strong hint of any continuation for this scene. It's the opening scene of the movie, after all. If you ask me, I think this scene would have just been best left for the movie entirely, and have it as just the opening for the sequel. So in the midst of all this, Krypton is about to be destroyed, and instead of saving loads of their race, Jor-El decides only his son should live. You know, if they had ways of sending people into space like that, why didn't they just evacuate the planet? Kal-El is then sent hurtling through space as an entire species of Kryptonians die horribly in the background.
Don't worry everyone, my son was the only person worth saving.
Damn you, Jor-El!
So the boy crash lands on, where else? Earth, and is found by a couple who, coincidentally, have no children of their own. My guess is they actually kept him because he would become handy for DIY in the future. The boy then grows up as Clark Kent and is wondering if he has a higher purpose in life. You know, the usual, who am I? Where am I going? What am I doing here? Well, lucky enough, his father is there to give him some useful advice. His Earth father, that is.
Things get very clear. And there's one thing I do know, son, and that is you are here for a reason.
And a good thing he did too, because the poor guy croaks 1 minute after giving him that all-important life lesson.
All those things I can do. All those powers. And I couldn't even save him.
So this sends Clark on a sort of spiritual mission, a sort of discover your true purpose in life. Again, which leads him to a crystal sort of palace where holograms of his real father emerge.
You do not remember me. I am Jor-El. I am your father.
Who am I?
Your name is Kal-El. You are the only survivor of the planet Krypton. Even though you've been raised As a human being, you are not one of them.
Okay, this is all kind of cool and all. The technology these crystals represent his father, and to be able to have a conversation with them is definitely a cool thing. And it also had the ability to give him a shiny new outfit. Oh god, that music is awesome. So now he's Superman. And we all know Superman's story. His alter ego is Clark Kent. He's really Superman, but his alter ego is really Clark Kent. And he's also the journalist for the Daily Planet. And is destined to be linked together with a mean yet lovable, get the story at any cost journal, Lois Lane. But his nemesis, Lex Luthor, played here great yet somewhat silly at times by Gene Hackman, is busy with his plan for the ultimate power. All in all, it just seems like your typical superhero movie that you would get today. You know, obviously the birth of the hero, his true origins, his purpose, and the love interest that he will protect at all costs, and the villain that is just using his next dastardly plan to kill the villain or take over the world. Part of the movie where Superman reveals himself to the world is great. It's filled with action, suspense, and humor.
You've got me! Who's got you?
It's alright. Here you go, miss.
Thanks, mister. Thank you. He was stuck in the tree. This man swooped at his eye and gave him to me.
Haven't I told you to stop telling lies?
I always love that moment. Sorry, beg your pardon. So Superman agrees to meet Lois to tell her about himself.
Definitely. Do you eat?
Yes.
Why are you here? There must be a reason for you to be here.
Yes. Hmm? I'm here to fight for truth and justice in the American way.
You're gonna end up fighting every elected official in this country.
And then there's this famous moment too. This has been spoofed countless times. My favorite actually had to be the one from Hot Shots. Still, as much as I love this film, this is a part of me that I don't really like. Don't get me wrong, it's shot well enough for the technology of the time. It's just schmaltzy as hell. Especially this moment.
Can you read my mind?
Meanwhile, Lex is determined to move ahead with his plan. He has developed a cunning plan to make a fortune in real estate by buying large amounts of barren desert land and then diverting two nuclear missile test flights to the San Andreas Fault, which will then sink the entire state of California, which will leave Luthor's desert as the new West Coast. But his blundering sidekick Otis accidentally makes a mistake and he directs the rocket to the wrong place. Then his girlfriend, Miss Testbacher.
Miss Testbacher!
I really love the way he shouts for her. You know, it's just awesome. Let's hear it again.
Testbacher!
Let's do it one more time.
Testbacher!
Okay, enough now. She manages to change the course of the second missile. But Lex Luthor knows that if anybody can stop him, it's Superman.
Well, know who you are. Well, I was probably 10 years old.
Only one thing alive with less than four legs can hear this frequency, Superman, and that's you. In approximately 5 minutes, a poison gas pellet containing propane lithium compound.
Now, where he got this technology, not explained. How is he using it? Not shown. So Clark decides that he must respond by jumping out a window, of course. In front of all of his colleagues. Just taking a shortcut home. Okay, Clark, see you tomorrow. And I never knew Superman had the ability to morph into his costume. I'm telling you, we are learning all sorts of new things about Superman here. So when he meets up with Luthor, Luthor does the cliched thing by telling Superman exactly what he's going to do and how he's going to do it and how you're never going to stop me, Superman.
It occurs to me that a 500 megaton bomb planted at just a proper point would
destroy most of California. Millions of innocent people would be killed. The West Coast as we know it would
fall into the sea. Bye-bye, California. Hello, new West Coast, my West Coast. Costa del X, Lutherville, Marina del X, Otisburg. Otisburg?
I don't know why, but I really would have wanted to see Otisburg over Costa del X.
Don't touch that. I told you. It's kryptonite.
Kryptonite! Now, where did he find that? Well, he explains earlier that he just took it from some meteorite somewhere. What sheer luck that it just happened to contain kryptonite.
Where are the other missiles headed, do you?
Certainly I do. I know exactly where it's headed. Hackensack, New Jersey.
Lex, my mother lives in Hackensack.
Yes, that bomb is going to kill your mother. Now, watch over the one person who could possibly save her for me, will you? So as you can tell, Ms. Tessbacher is going to save Superman, of course. But only on the condition that he save her mother first, knowing from his interview with Lois that he can't lie. He does manage to stop that missile, but is unfortunately unable to stop the one that hits California. But it doesn't help that Lois and Jimmy, yeah, Jimmy, the forgotten other main character of the Superman series. Seriously, does anybody even really care about that guy? They're both in California, so Superman, using all his speed, strength, attempts to quell the ensuing earthquake, saving lives and saving the day. So, when he thinks it's all over, he manages to know that Lois is in trouble. He then rushes to her with his oh-so-fast super speed all of a sudden. And he manages to get the car out from the ground and pull her out. But he is too late. Lois is dead. I'm sorry, Superman. Guess you have to learn to be a lot faster in future. Superman now decides to interfere with human history, even though he's forbidden, and wow! Jesus, look how fast he's going there! You know, if he had used that speed in the first place, he could have got those two missiles several times over. And how, in the name of God, does this turn back time? Where is the logic in this, folks? Where? This, ladies and gentlemen, was a really dumb moment in this movie, and it still really, mars it down today. People can't get over this moment. So, Superman saved the day after all. He brings Otis and Luthor into justice. Yeah, he just drops them off in a prison. No trial or anything. Guess he doesn't really stand for truth, justice, and democracy in the American way after all.
This country is safe again, Superman. Thanks to you.
No, sir. Don't thank me, Warden. We're all part of the same team.
Ugh, right. That's the last little thing that I hate. Just that line. It's just cheesy. It's just too corny. And so that is Superman. And you know what? It's a great movie. It may be flawed in a lot of areas, but I would just not look too much into it. Yeah, some of the things may have annoyed me, irritated me, but not. It doesn't really drag it down that much, except for the bit at the end. You know, the turning back the time thing, that was just really silly. But it has a great cast of characters as well as the actors who played him. Christopher Reeve is just charismatic as both Clark Kent and Superman. Margaret Kidder was also great as Lois Lane. And yes, even Gene Hackman's incredibly silly portrayal of Lex Luthor is great. You know, he is fun to watch. I can't deny that. The flying scenes were pretty damn cool, and the earthquake scene is just awesome. One thing I will say about this movie, though, the best thing about it is the John Williams score. I honestly say this is one of the best movie themes ever. Who doesn't love listening to this? So that's Superman 1, and join me next time and I'll talk about its sequel, Superman 2. So, stay tuned.